The encounter at 10,000 feet. The commander could tell how long each man on the bridge had been an airman by their reaction to the lightning. The novices and the new recruits still became wide-eyed at the sight, and they would always jump slightly at the following clamor. Those that had been aloft for half a decade or so were still interested enough to look out the vast glass windshield at the face of the bridge to spot the bolts, and count the seconds before the thunder. The seasoned officers didn't register it as a cause for alarm, or even to acknowledge. When the sky was split, they would blink only twice. Sky Commander Algernon Fielding didn't blink at all. Not one bead of sweat adorned his unwrinkled brow. His focus was fixed upon his crew from the command deck. On the earth below, people could hide behind the facades of their social graces or notoriety. But the high ether had a way of revealing a man's true character.
"Increase starboard propeller to 500 revolutions, he commanded in a clear and confident tone. The helmsman repeated the command to verify that he had heard it, and obliged, moving the throttle lever to 500 revolutions. The RAS Bellerophon sped forward, besieged on all sides by the tempest's merciless winds. Its colossal propellers strained in near futility to keep the destroyer aloft against forces tenfold stronger than the engines that sustained it. The vessel's thick iron hull groaned under the gale, and to the airmen on board it sounded as if the Bellerophon were in the tightening grip of some unforgiving giant who at a whim could crush the life out of them and toss their derelict carcass into the North Sea below. But they carried on about their stations as ordered, with breakneck efficiency. Crewmen in deep navy uniforms sped to keep up with the storm, turning valves and throwing switches, each attending to their respective instruments with military diligence. Their thick-lensed goggles hid the unease in their eyes, not at the storm, but what waited beyond it. Commander Fielding was not thrilled about their charge either, but he knew that it was an honor to be heading up the fleet against Baron Eisenfaust's fortifications at The Hague. Fielding was only a corporal when the war had begun 15 years ago. Like the rest of his fellow British patriots, he had been outraged at the news of Prince Albert's death. In fact, he had been one of the first to volunteer for the war effort against Bavaria. His sense of duty to Queen and country had never been stronger then. But in 15 years of seemingly endless conflict, with relatively stagnant progress, Fielding's light brown hair had begun to gray. His ardency had begun to dwindle, but that of his fellow soldiers seemed only to increase.
"Quite abrasive, this weather," came the Grand Admiral's voice from behind him.
"Yes, sir," replied Commander Fielding, turning to face his superior officer. "Though I'm certain you've flown through storms that were twice as turbulent as this, Admiral."
The older man nodded in affirmation.
"Indeed. Though I must admit not on a vessel so efficiently crewed as this one."
One or two of the crewmen turned from their instruments at the compliment. Though it was an honor for all of them to be carrying the Grand Admiral on board, his presence made them nervous.
There wasn't a man among them who hadn't heard of Grand Admiral Warwick Rockfort. He was the only member of Queen Victoria's Ministry of War who famously still took to the theater of battle. The deep lines in his face and his iron-gray hair put the men in mind of a wolf. His crimson uniform stood out amongst those of the navy-attired crewmen, who avoided his partially mechanical gaze as if it were the barrel of a gun. Most high-ranking airmen, like Commander Fielding, wore a hyper-optic monogoggle. Grand Admiral Rockfort wore his monocle over where his left eye once was, masking the mechanical prosthesis behind it.
but the sound of its every clicking, whirring movement were audible as he shifted his sight. Even beneath the roar of the tempest, the crew could hear his eye upon them.
"Thank you, sir," replied Commander Fielding on behalf of his crew. "I'm certain your presence inspires their efficiency. It is a rare occasion that we are accompanied by an officer of your rank."
The Admiral uttered a slight chuckle at this statement.
"Do not be modest, Commander Fielding," he retorted, stroking the pommel of his saber. "I am told it is your excellent command that inspires their efficiency."
The commander thanked his superior with a slight nod in the midst of his words.
"There are gentlemen of higher rank than yourself who are not so handsomely decorated," continued the Admiral, indicating the sword on Fielding's belt.
The venerable falchion of the realm was a weapon awarded to only an honored few of the Empire's servants. Commander Fielding had been presented it by the Queen herself for his actions at the Battle of the Thames Estuary. The RAS Vanguard had been diverted towards London, having been damaged by the invading Bavarian fleet. The then Sergeant Fielding was the only man left alive on the bridge, and successfully crash-landed the dreadnought ship in the river, avoiding a surely catastrophic simultaneous collision with one of the country's public telecommunication towers and airship ports. Fielding's bravery was awarded with his promotion to Sky Commander and the presentation of the falchion. It was an act of heroism that was spoken of throughout the Empire, but Fielding preferred not to think about it. He could feel his nerves tense at the Admiral's mention of it. A sudden push of turbulence rocked the Bellerophon slightly. Commander Fielding turned to his crew and announced,
"Compensate on port propeller, and even up, Mr. Kemp."
The helmsman replied,
"Aye, Commander,"
turning the wheel and pushing forward the port throttle. The ship evened out its balance once more, and continued its passage through the tempestuous clouds.
"Current altitude 9,000 feet, Commander," declared the navigator.
Fielding responded confidently,
"Continue ascent."
He was grateful for the temporary distraction from the matter of his decoration, but it was short-lived as the Admiral continued to speak.
"Your exceptional record has been greatly applauded within the Ministry,"
related the Admiral, all the while stroking the pommel of his saber. Fielding could do nothing but say,
"Thank you, sir,"
to the Admiral.
"Although it was a great honor to have been chosen to lead the British fleet into Bavarian airspace, accompanied by a member of Her Majesty's Cabinet, Commander Fielding could not help but think of the Grand Admiral's presence as not so much a supervisor, but a warden. He wondered if Admiral Rochefort was aware of what had really occurred on the bridge of the Vanguard before its acclaimed crash landing. If perhaps the Ministry had sent him not out of commendation, but of concern. Perhaps they had questions concerning the fate of the Vanguard's former commander. Perhaps they even knew of what he had attempted before his demise, and what Fielding had done to stop him. Commander Fielding couldn't be sure of anything. The Admiral had now begun to slowly circle behind him.
If this mission goes according to plan, there may be talk of an additional promotion in your future."
There was something slightly unfavorable in the Admiral's voice. Commander Fielding did not make retort. Instead, he kept his eyes transfixed on the howling wilderness beyond the concave glass wall at the head of the bridge, contemplating the battle that lay at the flight's end, and how he had come to be flying for it.